Took my cues from you.
You do.
You can blame it all on me. I did some damage to you.
Yes.
Just tell me how to fix it.
Hello.
Just tell me how to fix it.
What's up, family? We trying to fix
hello,
it right
hello,
now.
Hello, hello, hello. How are y'all doing on tonight?
How's the
good
family?
Good evening.
Good evening, family. How y'all doing out there? I know y'all ready. Y'all couldn't wait for this episode. I know it. I feel it.
We are continuing with the five love languages, okay? Yes, we are. Now, we know we talked about quality time. What else did we talk about? Affirming.
Affirming.
We talked about those two. And we got those five love languages, a very powerful book called The Five Love Languages by Gary Chapman. So if you didn't get this book already, it is a must read, okay? But tonight we are going to tackle the last three.
Last three, okay? Guys.
They are very powerful love languages.
Very.
Okay. We're going to talk about acts of service. We're going to talk about physical touch. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about receiving gifts. Okay. Some of this that we're going to talk about, I mean, you may get a different perspective. Okay. You may hear some different things. Okay.
You just may.
Okay. Who knows? Okay.
Stick around and find out.
But thank y'all for joining us again. Welcome into the Q&A house.
Q&A.
Okay. Thank y'all for riding this journey with us. And we are just excited. And so thank you again for the ride. Okay. Well, I don't know. Let's see. I have posed a question. I don't know if you saw it already, but I posed a question that if you know your love language, what is it? And knowing the love language, does your partner, your significant other, your spouse, does he or she know what your love language is? That's good. Okay? That's real good.
Is your significant other, your spouse, your mate, how familiar are they with your love language?
Mm-hmm.
And all that ties into effective communication. Remember, all this just flows. You know, it one goes right into the other. They all intertwine. So you have to figure out, know one way or another, I should say, how familiar your spouse is with your love language. And if you effectively communicate, that leads right into that. Now, if you don't, if there's no familiarity there, then there's some work to do. There's some, as we stated in a couple of podcasts ago, there's some prereqs that you have to take care of before you get into the curriculum. Y'all follow?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this is some good stuff, y'all. These last three, me and my wife, we were talking, me and Q were talking earlier in the week, you know, throughout the week about the podcast, like we always do. We just bantering back and forth and, you know, just laying out ideas or, you know, whatever questions. And it's like, okay, those last three, all of them are important, and they hold some, you know, weight and value. to us all. Some, you know, some people may lean more towards this one. Some may lean more towards the other one. They all are important. But though I was telling Q, I said those last three seem like just because of how it all went, these are the last three. It's like those, all of those put together, it's like it's a powerful and a potent mix. So there's probably going to be some good stuff come out of these last three tonight.
Yes, I would definitely say so. I am really, I think I'm going to save a couple, the last two that I think in my mind are kind of powerful. They all are. But let's talk about the first one, receiving gifts.
Come on.
Okay.
Let's talk
about it. Just like my husband was saying, and what we were talking about the other day, and periodically all this week about this, is that people relate gifts as something, as you call it, tangible. Okay. Ooh, you know, you get a box with a big bow on it, or you get a bag that has stuff in it, and you know, you think of those tangible gifts like that, things that you can touch. But what about the gifts that's not even tangible? That's not, you can't even touch it.
Right.
You know, you can't go buy it. What about those gifts? Have you thought about that? Yes. So with receiving gifts, you know, what if you're one that's your love language and you would like to receive gifts? But what if that gift, you're not a flower person, you're not teddy bear, you know, you don't really like stuff like that, but a gift to you is making sure the trash is out, you know, when it overflows. Or a gift to you is making sure that the tank is full and you ain't got to stop and get no gas. Mm-hmm. But a gift is like, you know, in the morning, like my baby do in the morning, and say, good morning, I love you. That is indeed a gift to me. So, and even me telling him, too, that a gift to me is my husband was my gift. My husband is my gift and my blessing. Even though, yeah, that's tangible, but God joined us together. Let no man put us under.
Come on.
Because God joined us together. And that was indeed my gift and my blessing. So I don't take that lightly. But think about it. In receiving gifts, it doesn't have to always be tangible gifts.
Right.
It doesn't. So, you know, what you think, eh?
Yeah. Sometimes it's your words. Sometimes it's a kind gesture. Can I be honest with you? Sometimes it's a smile. I do my wife this all the time. I do Q this all the time. I'll wait till she's stirring around and maybe her attention is on something else. Not that it's not on me, but y'all know what I mean. I mean, she's into some other task or chore, and it's really gotten her focus or whatever, her immediate attention. So she's all into it. And I'll be standing across the room, y'all, and sometimes I'll lock in on her and just stare. And we're so connected till she feels it. She can sense something, and especially if I'm too quiet, because any of y'all who know me know I'm not a quiet person, I don't think, by any stretch of the imagination. No. If I am quiet, then there's something else going on. Mm-hmm. But if I get real quiet, Q is so keen, she senses something. Okay, let me turn around. Mm-hmm. Let me check for him. Let me call his name, babe or Aaron or whatever. And she'll be, a lot of times, just a few feet across the room, and I'll be just standing there, y'all, smiling. I tell her, I say, I don't even need a reason to smile. You're the reason that I smile. You know, Shanice, that record of some years ago, I love your smile. I do love her smile. I always tell her she has a gorgeous smile. But her presence, her essence makes me smile. So when she looks across the room, she turns around and is like, okay, I know this man. He's doing something and I'm just not aware. Let me turn around and see what he's doing. And she'll turn around, y'all, and she'll look at me. She'll be like, what? Oh, babe, why are you just smiling like that? I say, it's you, sweetheart. I say, you bring that out of me. You compel me. You cause me to smile. So she says that's a gift to her. I just smile at her. And her gift to me is she encourages me. She pushes me forward. She tells me I can do it. I can go out there and conquer the world. Matter of fact, you can create your own world and then conquer it too. So that's her gift to me. That's how I receive it. Like she said, it's not a tangible thing. It's not anything you could wrap your five senses around, or you can put your hands on. But a lot of times, as they say, the matters of the heart are more important than even the physical things that we can touch or feel.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just my little take, Q. That's my little, I said my little nickel dime quarter. It's not even a whole dollar, it's just a nickel dime or quarter. Just a little something.
Really? Yeah. This is, I think, as all of them are, another important love language. And make sure that you know exactly what you're needing and wanting from your person, from your partner, your significant other, your baby, sugar, honey, all of it. Make sure that, we talked about it before, about effective communication. Make sure that they know what your love language is.
Right.
I mean, so your needs and even your wants can be met. I mean, that's what they're there for, among other things. And you know, as my husband and I always talk, we're so focused on making sure that the other person, like I'm so wanting to make sure that he's okay, and
I'm so wanting to make sure she's okay. It's reciprocated,
yes.
So no one is ever left out in the cold.
There you go. No one is ever lacking. If you're concentrating on the other person and they're concentrating on you, there should be no lacking. There should be nothing that you need outside of you two.
Right, because you're putting the other person first.
Absolutely.
You're putting their needs first.
As well as you're supposed to.
Right, and in turn, they're doing the same thing. And that's a beautiful, that's another thing. It can be trying and even taxing when one person, we've all heard this, I'm going to go ahead on and just throw a few numbers out there. We've all heard that 50-50 thing, 50-50, 70-30, 60-40, like that song, you know, and all of these different percentages, but that's really not accurate. And the way me and Q see it, not even the traditional or the famous 50-50, if you will, it would even suffice. It's really 100-100.
Yeah.
Because if you have two parts, you know what I'm saying? You don't have a whole.
Yeah, you have to have a whole.
Each part has to have a whole.
Yeah.
So that the whole thing can be whole. Y'all follow me?
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. So true, babe. So true. And just with the receiving of the gifts, you know, just make sure that if it's not tangible, if it's not something that you want to receive, like I said before, then ask what you want. It's
right.
Okay. Ask what you're desiring from your person so you can get it. Because if you don't communicate with them, how are they supposed to know? So receiving gifts, like I said, it's not always tangible. It could be the little things. It could be the spoken or words that you need that can lift you up. It could be just, you know, a thing that you're desiring that you need help with, that could be a gift to you. So, you know, that's very powerful. And that leads me into the next gift, which is the next love language, which is acts of service. Now, this one is very
watch out
powerful to me. One of them that are powerful to me, because I have several. But acts of service, man, that's a lot.
That's loaded right there, y'all. That's fully locked and loaded.
I mean, we talk about acts meaning action, acts.
Mm-hmm.
There's several actions that you can do. There's several things that you can do. It's acts of service.
Acts and
so
keyword acts meaning ACTS, plural, not singular.
Right.
Acts of, not at one time, and they're like, okay, I'm good,
I'm done.
I've done this. I'm straight for a minute. In other words, my spouse is straight because I did that one thing that they wanted.
Yeah.
No, it's acts, meaning on, plural, ongoing and continuous.
That it is. Yep. Okay. And before I even go to my next point, please forgive me. Please tag, like, share, if y'all are liking or loving the things that you're hearing, if you're loving Q&A House, please like, tag, share. Have people come on in and see what we're talking about and riding this journey with us. I promise you, you never know what you're going to get from week to week, okay?
Right.
So come on in and just like us and you know, share it with somebody else. Share what you're hearing, and that can help somebody else. So you never know. So please do that. But continue about talking about acts of service. Acts of service to me is you being a servant, you being available, you're being dependable, you're providing what God has already placed in you, your heart, your emotion,
your compassion, your empathy,
all of that, babe. Oh. Mm-hmm. And you're there giving that to your spouse. That indeed is a service. Like, acts of service could be so many things. It's just an array of things that I can serve my husband, which I do every day. So I can serve him by making sure his clothes is clean. I can serve him by fixing his dinner, making sure that he get fed. And brother, get fed.
Brother, get fed, y'all.
Please believe. Also, making sure, I mean, there's so many things that I can make sure that he is never lacking, because believe it or not, the five love languages, it's all a part of intimacy. Into me, you see. Intimacy.
Mm, I like, that's good. Ooh, that's good.
Into me.
Intimacy.
See.
Mm.
Into me.
Do you see?
Come on. Ooh. Come on. That's what intimacy is. And all, the five love languages, these love languages is a part of that. So when we talk about intimacy, it's not always, and it's not just relegated to physical sex.
Ooh, that was my word I was about to use. You said it. I was thinking.
It's not. We're not just talking about sex. Okay?
It's not just
that. That is a part of it, but we're not just talking about sex. Intimacy is just being there emotionally, being available, and being there.
We have a support.
Yes.
Intimacy can be this. Just to give y'all a little small example. Yeah. We all familiar with this one. You know, touch is common to us all.
And that's the last one we're gonna talk about.
Is that touch? I don't want to jump the gun.
Yeah.
But it could be this. You know what I'm saying? Just touching. Just mm-hmm. just holding hands. You know. Mm-hmm. And I do that a lot. I grab my wife's hands a lot. So I like to make that contact with. But do continue.
But yeah, acts of service is an array of things. We are all servants. So you have to make sure you're serving even before you go out of the home. Mm-hmm. You know, even the Word of God talks about taking care of home first. You have to make sure your home is taken care of before you go outside, even to the church, your job, you know, mm-hmm. anything. If you're taking care of that and you're neglecting home, you're out of order. So that ain't even God at all. Mm-hmm. So you have to make sure you're taking care of home, especially in a marriage, especially being married. You have to make sure that they are the priority. My husband is my priority. Making sure that his needs is met as well as his wants. But, you know, I serve. I'm here to serve. I'm here to serve. That is plain as I can put it. I am here to serve. And I don't mind serving my husband. And that is a lot. That is very loaded in being available and being there to serve in the capacity as me being a wife on a daily basis. It's not something that it only happens certain times of the year. It's not something that is only holidays. It's not something that, you know, I only do three times a week. No, ma'am. No, sir. It is 7 days a week. We don't sleep. Okay, it's 365 days, 7 days a week.
24 hours a day.
24/7.
Okay? And it's not a actual thing where, you know, you got to be doing something that, oh, we don't mean to make it sound so, like, you know, outrageous and far-fetched. Like, I got to be doing something every minute, every second.
Hey, mommy.
Hey, mom. Sorry. Hey, mom. And all family was tuned in. But it's the attitude. It's the mindset.
Absolutely.
You know, you have to be in a continuous mindset to serve. Service is actually a mindset. It's not so much the actual physical. I'll put it like this. It's not just limited to the physical. Yes, the acts of service do have to be seen, have to be visualized. At the same time, you have to have the mindset for it. And we all probably been knowing this all of our lives and since we was little. You know, you've been told this. It's been drilled into your thinking, which is the truth. Everything starts in the mind. Everything that's tangible, that's natural, that manifests, it had to start up here in the mind. It had to be a vision. Yes. It had to be a seed.
Yes.
You know, it had to be planted. It had to be watered and fertilized and then it grew. Whichever that seed may be, that go both ways, good or bad.
Yes.
It was a seed first. It was a thought.
Yes.
You know, so it has to be the mindset. And I want to pose this question. Can I pose this question?
Yes, huh?
What do you guys know? We don't want to just be talking. It's just rambling. What do you guys consider acts of service? And everybody's, you know, there's no right or wrong answer. Everybody's interpretation is different. I believe Q kind of, clarified that too. Everybody's different. So whatever your perspective is, please put it in the comments, in the chat. You know, if you have questions, y'all know how we do it. This is family. We family.
Absolutely.
So you ask your questions, you put your comments or remarks, you know, or whatever, your little sayings, expressions, y'all welcome to do it. But what would you consider acts of service between you and your spouse? I know with me and Q is different things. I remember one time she came home from work and I had been sensing that she had a rough day. This was a couple of months back and I was home, I was off. So I made it a point. I just fixed in my mind, let me do certain things around this house to make sure that when my wife gets home, it's less stressful than the place that she come from. You know what I'm saying? This should be her safe haven, her sanctuary. So let me do a few things. I just took it upon myself. Maybe, you know, God just impressed it upon me. And sure enough, y'all, sure enough, as my granny would say, sure enough, she came home and she walked in the kitchen, kissed her, hey, sweetheart, you know, good evening, what have you. And she walked in the kitchen, looked down into the sink, and the sink was clear. I did dishes, put dishes away. I did other housework, too, did some cleaning up, did some washing. And she was just elated. She said, baby, thank you so much. I'm saying all that to say this, not to brag or to boast, but I'm saying all that to say this. She so appreciated just those little acts of service.
Absolutely.
Of, you know, that she considered that being considerate of her. No, she did not ask. She didn't leave me no honey-do list, honey-do this, honey-do that. She didn't place any demands. She never does. She was just her usual self. She doesn't put any pressure on. But because she didn't put any pressure on, I was compelled. I said, you know what? Let me relieve her some of the stuff she would come home and find. She'd feel like, let me get here and do this. Let me tend to my husband. I got to feed him. I knocked out quite a bit. And she was like, baby, thank you so much. So I'm more than sure that evening went pretty smooth. So whatever I may have asked, I don't think I asked anything of her because I don't really put pressure on her either, ask much of her. But whatever I may have asked or chosen to ask her, came to mind to ask her, she was like, baby, you know what? You good. You got that. I don't even have a problem with it because you were here. You were off the day. You considered me enough to do a few things that you figured would help me out. So whatever your request is, you know, you got it.
Come on. So, and we are a team.
We are a team.
Ain't no I in team. And teamwork, as they say, makes the dream work.
And it does.
And we really do because he is a awesome man of God. I want to read an insert that was in this book. And it says, no one likes to be forced to do anything. Love is always freely given. So true.
So very true.
No one likes to be forced to do anything. Why would I have to be forced to do what is already in me to do?
Come on.
I am a servant by nature, servant by heart anyway, and I love what I do. So nobody, my husband don't have to force me to do things that already come natural, but what if it doesn't? Okay, what if you're having a hard time with that, then be okay and, you know, say that and then find out what that is for you.
Right.
You know, it's okay. That may not be your love language.
Right.
Find out what it is and then act upon it. Because as you give, it will be given back to you. Like everything that I do, I don't do it to get something, but my return, woo-hoo! Because my husband's heart, we are a lot, so much alike.
So much, y'all.
And what I give to him, he gives me back 100-fold. We do each other like that. So it is very powerful when you have two people that have become one and y'all are acting upon that together.
It is so powerful.
Very powerful. Very, very powerful. Love is very powerful. And you do not have to be forced to do anything.
Right.
Okay?
And you say something so key. When something is in you, it's in you. My grandmother used to say this along when I was growing up.
Hey, Mama Mary. Sorry, baby.
Hey, Mama Mary. love you. Whatever's in you, it comes out of you. You know, you can't hide it. You can't stuff it. You can't suppress it.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, it's going to come to the surface. You know, it's going to come to the surface. What another saying, I used to hear this growing up, say, whatever you do, of course, whatever you do in the dark,
yes,
I'll be brought to light.
Yes.
Whatever you do in the bed chamber or whatever is going to come out on the dinner table. I tell you, the old folks, they had some sayings and they had a certain way of putting things. I'm telling you, it would just blow your mind, you know, when you were growing up, because you didn't, of course, fully understand like an adult did, but you would hear these things constantly. But in your adulthood now, you fully grasp, or you for the most part, you grasp where the old folk was coming from. They might have a strange, unorthodox way of saying things. Most times they did, you would laugh. You're like, what granny talking about? What papa talking about? But then now looking at it now, as you know, many years later, you're an adult, you're like, wow, I see what they meant. Especially as it pertains to relationship, but we had an occurrence this morning. My wife was getting ready for work, and she had something going on with her shoe. She had actually picked up a nail or a tack in the bottom of her tennis shoe, and then they had a few inches from that was some gum that had dried.
Hey, Travis! Hey, my brother!
Hey, Mr. Travis, how are you, sir? Glad you tuned in. We know you see. We see you got the message.
We're praying for you, and we're praying for mom. So I want you to know that we're continuing to pray.
Yes, sir. We're praying.
And know that God is able, and God will do.
Yes,
just
He will.
What He said, okay?
Yes, He
is a healer, and we know that to be true.
Yes, He
so
is.
So we wanted to shout out and tell you that for sure.
Thank you, my brother.
Thank you so much for tuning in.
Yes.
I'm sorry, baby.
No, it's okay. But like as I was saying, you know, there was the little nail, a little tack in the bottom of her tennis shoe. And it, a few inches from that was some gum that had been stuck to it. So what I do, I say, reach me your foot, sweetheart. So she lifts up her foot. She knew what was about to happen. Took it off right here in the kitchen.
She does quite often.
I got a tool, screwed down a little needle nose pliers where I pulled the tack out, got that taken care of, scraped the gum off, you know, and put her shoe back on her foot. She probably wasn't expecting this, but it's typical of me. I put her shoe back on. I'm the one took it off. So, you know, it made sense to me logically, put it back on. And then I tied it. She said, baby, you didn't have to do that. And me in my typical A fashion, I said, sweetheart, I looked up at her. I said, I'm your husband. Of course I was supposed to do that. She was like, thank you, babe. So, you know, that was a moment. And we both went to work. So, you know, I'm saying this particularly to the fellas. It's okay. There's nothing wrong with, you know, putting your wife's shoes on, tying them up. Putting the buckle or whatever, putting a little strap through. I've done all that, you know, helping with our jewelry, helping with our hair, whatever she may need. Sometimes she's asked, but a lot of times she don't. I just come in. I'm compelled, as I was just stating, what my grandmother used to say many years ago, what's in you, it comes out of you. If that's already in you, it's going to come out.
Yeah.
At the same time, if that's not in you, as Q was saying, if that's not your love language or how you do things, or maybe, you know, you're not, you know, in that area, that's just not something you really flow in. That's okay. Don't condemn yourself. We're not condemning. There's no judgment here. But don't condemn yourself. But that's where it takes a little, what I call W-E, a little work and a little effort.
Come on.
A little work, a little effort. We, you know, like Q said, there's no I And no. 10 is we.
Yes.
So put in a little we, a little W, a little work, a little effort, and you find out what that is, yes. And then you can cultivate that, then you can move on.
Yes.
So
come on, cultivate. You better come on, yes.
It's because of you, sweetheart, because of you. You done cultivated some stuff.
Well, thank you. Again, we've talked about affirmation. Mm-hmm. We talked about quality time. Mm-hmm. We just talked about receiving gifts. Mm-hmm. We talked about acts of service.
Acts of service.
That's the four love languages. Our last one is physical touch. Okay, physical touch. We all know what that is. Okay, and again, that's more than just sex.
Right.
Okay, come on, y'all.
Let your mind be free. Let it expand.
Physical touch is just what it is. Physical touch. But how are you touching? Like I tell my husband all the time, because he is so touchy-feely that he will go and just brush up on me.
You're going to go ahead and tell him, huh?
Yeah. Or just come behind my back. Or just come up to me and kiss my neck. It's little things like that. As some may call it foreplay during the day. I mean,
and maybe technically it is.
I don't know.
But it's with good intention. Your heart is in the right place. You just want to show affection to your spouse.
It's affection. Affection, ladies and gentlemen, men and women. It is affection. Okay, everybody. We saw what COVID did. During the time, and we had to be isolated, we couldn't be by the people that we loved, and even some that were living in the household. It became rough because you weren't used to being with each other that long, those hours 24/7 every day, you know, that kind of thing. But we saw what not being around people did, and how, you know, it was very hard for a lot of us not being around people. And with the physical touch, you have, I mean, that in and of itself, physical touch, be careful how you even touch.
Yes.
You know, some touch ain't even good. Some touch is negative, you know, and you know, okay?
Some touch, I'm going to go ahead and say it. Some touch is even borderline and even over the line abusive.
Uh-huh.
You know, come here, girl. You know, you could touch a certain type of way, pull, jet, and it has all of the markings of, you know, not so pleasant things or things you should not be doing, particularly towards your spouse, fellas.
Hey, Lady Devon.
How you doing? Good to see you, sis. But yeah, we have to be so careful. It's the way you do things, how they say the manner in which, the context in which
absolutely.
You do things
absolutely.
Makes all the difference in the world. The voice, me and Kim talk about all of these things. You know, trust me, we get down with it before we get on and talk to y'all. Voice inflection, tone, pitch, all of that matters. You can say something one way and make a person there. You can say something and just destroy their world.
And Q ain't always got it together.
What? No, wait a minute.
I don't always get it right.
No,
okay?
It can't be.
Because, you know, sometimes my tone can be a little, as my husband said, just a little touch. A little abrasive. A little touch, okay? Some that tone ain't right. So I get checked sometimes, okay?
What you say?
It is okay. But that is in love. Just like the Lord chastens us when we not doing what we supposed to do.
It's real talk.
You're going to get that even in marriage, in relationships. That is good. You want that. If you had somebody that wasn't saying nothing, then and they didn't check out, that's because they don't care. Yeah. They already out the door. Okay? So you that would be alarming for anybody. So you want them. That means they care. That means they want you to be better. That means that they know you're better than that. So always self-check yourself. And I again, Q don't always get it right. Okay? Mm-hmm. I'm still having to check myself and make sure my tone, and I seriously, I don't always get it right. And it's more than just with my husband. It's other relationships that even I have still, that sometimes I could be like that tone could be a little sharp or a little, you know, abrasive. And I don't mean no harm. It just comes off that way because the inner me is not meaning it, but it just comes off that way out of my voice. So again, you want to always do a self-check. Check up yourself to make sure that you're doing what you're supposed to do, because you're only responsible. Get this. If you don't get nothing else, you are only responsible for yourself. You cannot make Joe Blow down the street do nothing. He grown. You are only responsible for yourself. If you stay in your lane and do what you're supposed to do, trust, it'll all be fine. Okay?
Come on.
But that physical touch is important. Because I tell my husband all the time, I love the way, I mean, just a brush. Just have, don't do it. Just a brush.
Like a little demonstration wouldn't hurt.
just the gliding of his hand down my shoulder, my arm. I mean, that's how you know. You feel the love. You feel the emotion that is in a touch. Okay, especially if it is positive and you know where it comes from and you know who it came from.
Mm-hmm.
So that physical touch is
everything.
It is.
And I'm going to add this. I love this. Your Q just, of course, she sparked this when we talk about all this physical touch. Because of our height difference, and it's like everything else with us. The height difference, our likes, dislikes, we just have to be so... We born one day apart, the same year, in two different places. It's just crazy. But even with the height difference between us, my height, her height, we fit perfectly. And what I mean by that is, if we having one of those tender moments, she'll lay her head in my chest or on my shoulder, and it seemed like she's the right height, I'm the right height. She lays like right in the groove, right in the cleft of the rock, as I call it, like the word said, right in the cleft of the rock, right on my shoulder, lay her head, and it's a beautiful feeling. It's like when she lay, when we make that contact, and she lays, and I hold and embrace. I'm telling y'all, it's like heaven on earth. And sometimes I'll be inspired, maybe to sing to her a little bit, or sing a little snippet of it. Like when that happens, when she lays her head on my shoulders, most of y'all know this song. I used to love it, you know, back in the day. Lay your head on my shoulder, hold me in your arms, baby. And a lot of times that'll come to my mind when she does that. She was like, I love my husband. She'll look up at me and I love you, baby. I love my husband. And she'll put that little head right down and on the shoulder, and that song will come to my mind. And I'm just like, we both could just get swept away. It's a beautiful thing, y'all. And that's not just resigned or relegated to Q&A to us. That can be for you and for anybody else out there who wants to. Trust me, you can have it. You just have to put in the work and you have to cultivate like everything else. Like a farmer does his crops, like a person at their job, they're good at their job, or they're passionate about what they do. Mm-hmm. They sow into it. They give themselves over to that thing all the time. Yeah. We have to do the same thing in relationship, the same way Christ, I'm gonna get real with y'all, the same way Christ is with the church, with us, his body.
Yes.
We're to say that's a type and shadow. That's a model and example for us. We do that with our spouses, and I'm talking specifically to the men. This is not just for the ladies, fellas. We got to do this too. I don't mean we like it's obligatory or, you know, it's our obligation and duty. We got to. I don't mean it like that. Meaning,
but you got to.
We got to, bro. Y'all heard it from Q. That's the boss lady. You got to.
But you got to.
For all intents and purposes. But you, in other words, you would want to. You should be moved or compelled to. Absolutely. I know with me, that's not even a struggle because I'm already like that.
Yeah.
So I'm always compelled to, you know what I'm saying, to show her love and to let her know she's loved. Yes, she knows she's loved. Yes, she hears it all the time. But sometimes that physical touch along with those words, I'm telling you, seals the deal. And she be like, babe. And I know it's come. She be like, babe, why you do this to me? And I just hold it. And that song comes to my mind. I'm telling you, we have our moments. But like I said, the same thing that we're blessed with, it, we enjoy it, you guys can enjoy that too. And that's our prayer, that you enjoy it, and you know, your relationship, your spouse the same way, and it's just as sweet and as blissful as y'all hear from the Q&A, you know, how it is in our house. So
yes, again, we have talked about the five love languages. I shared how important this book is by Gary Chapman. If you have not got this book, read it, and also applied it to your life, it is a good read and a good application that you can apply to your relationship. I promise you that. It is very powerful to not only know what your love language is, but be able to give it, to be a receiver of it as well. Powerful. Powerful.
By all means, please take what we're saying, what we're sharing with you about these five love languages, and just, you know, little bit by little bit, you know, just implement certain things. We understand it doesn't all, like anything else, it doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't all come in a day. You know, how's the saying? What's the saying? Wrong one built in a day.
Come on.
These big corporations and these businesses that we know and we frequent or we patronize and we know so well, and if, you know, just calling the name of it, you know, everybody's familiar. Mm-hmm. But even those men and those women who started those businesses, if you tune into a documentary or listen to their biography or whatever, they'll even tell you that I didn't do this overnight. This didn't happen. I slept under my desk. I ate cheese sandwiches back in the days when I didn't have any money. I slept in my car, whatever, to build this dream, to see this vision come to fruition. So you have to treat, basically, we're using all of these illustrations and these examples to get you to understand that you have to do the same thing with your relationship. I use something that a lot of us can relate to. A lot of us like the gym, love the gym. Some of us, we're fanatical behind the gym. We will work out if we don't do nothing else. And when we go and work on to get that body in shape, we train, we discipline our body. We have to train and discipline our relationships the same way. Am I right, Q?
That's right.
Let me know if I'm on it, if I'm listening.
You on it, baby.
You have to train and take that relationship, take your relationship to the gym. Put it on the treadmill.
Okay.
You know, do some curls, some bench presses, some lifting. You know, some power lifting. You know, you want it to be strong and have muscles and be strong and full of vitality. Well, you gotta feed. Same thing with your physical body. Don't feed your physical body for 2-3 weeks. Don't eat or drink nothing. And watch, you might not be here. But you know, a lot of times we take it, we treat our relationships, we kind of treat it like, you know what I'm saying, like an outcast. Mm-hmm. Oh, I get to it. If I have time, you know, if I feel like being bothered, we gotta make our relationships, our marriages top priority, y'all. Because if we
Absolutely.
Don't, nobody else will. And if you don't, then who's gonna tend to it? It's gonna wither up, you know. It's gonna be sickly, and it's gonna die eventually. You know, God forbid.
Yeah.
You know, we're not speaking that kind of stuff, but we're just being real with you right now. If you don't, that's what it could lead to. Just like everything else we understand about life. If
yes.
you do cause and effect, if you do this, then you get that. If
yeah.
you don't do this, then you will get that. And it's just that simple.
Yes, with just with what you were saying, I mean, you have to make sure that you're in a constant mode,
yes.
which means if you're constant, then you keep on moving. It is a forward progress.
Yeah.
Okay. And you want to always be aware, always be mindful every day of your person,
mm-hmm.
of your spouse. As they say, you can't sleep on it. Okay,
mm-hmm.
you can't, you know, ignore it one day and then pick it back up and want to tend to it that day, because you probably missed something the day you ignored it. Okay, you don't
Come
want
on.
To
that's good.
You don't want to miss it, because then you trying to play catch up, and then you wonder what didn't happen when something come out of left field,
right?
And then you trying to figure it out. No, boo, sugar. Okay, you should have been paying attention. Again, that brings me even back to what we were talking about before, effective communication.
Effective.
You have to make sure that y'all are constantly communicating about everything, for real. So with that, there will be no lag. You won't allow a crack to open for the enemy to come in
That's
and wreak
right.
havoc. So you're constantly in prayer mode. You're constantly working as a team. Y'all are constantly moving forward together, not he on one road and you on another, and y'all ain't came together. No. And what does the word talk about? The two walk together.
The two, yeah, become one. Let's how can agree. Two walk together unless they agree?
There you go. How
you're no
two,
longer twain, but yeah, you're one.
How can two walk together unless they agree? Mm-hmm. Okay, right. Come on. That means that y'all got to be having some communication.
Yeah.
That means y'all got to be on the same page.
Mm-hmm.
That means, and no, we're not saying that y'all, that nobody is going to be, ain't nothing what they call fail-proof.
Nothing foolproof.
Ain't nothing foolproof. Mm-hmm. That's what I said. Ain't nothing foolproof. You gotta constantly, when you're constantly knowing what's going on and y'all are constantly having dialogue, okay, you can't allow the enemy to come in. Okay, and when you're constantly doing that and you're staying in the face of God and staying in prayer, then that ain't gonna happen. Okay, but if you get off your job, you get out of your lane, you get out of your position,
you clock out early and go home.
Come on,
look,
if you not on it, then what happens? Okay, so many things can happen even in a minuscule of time,
right?
A minute of time. There's so many things that can happen, and it don't take long. I mean, just like that, something can change. Something can happen, and you wonder, like, what just happened?
Mm-hmm.
No, sugar. Don't do it.
And can I say this?
Constantly, stay before God.
And this just came to me. You can take it for what it is. You may or may not agree, but it just dawned on me. It just dropped on me just now. Even in that, in ineffective communication, you can be unequally yoked.
Yeah.
Your yoke can be unequal because you won't put in the W-E to cultivate, to develop it.
Yeah.
So, you know, and just like...
That's a whole nother set.
But just like we shed light and maybe brought another perspective to things that we've been hearing all our Christian life, I've been knowing. Yeah. Even with that just hit me just now, y'all. It's not just meaning, you know, somebody that's totally heathenistic and you danced up and down the aisles and hopping pews every Sunday and they don't want to have nothing to do with the Lord. It's not just in that. You can even be unequally yoked, or the yoke can be unequal because you're allowing it. As Pew say, you're allowing the cracks. You're allowing the little slivers of, you know, light from the outside to come in. You're allowing chinks in the armor. You know, gaps or even holes sometimes in any and every kind of critter is getting in and coming in and eating up and destroying everything.
Yes.
Just like we wouldn't leave our doors unlocked. We wouldn't go to sleep with the front door wide open. We're asking for trouble. We wouldn't leave the car unlocked or leave the doors bust wide open sitting in the driveway and not expecting to be, you know, the vehicle to be missing. Or the stuff to be taken out of the vehicle, stripped down in the morning or whatever, are not expecting an intruder to just come in your house and help themselves. The same way we treat our physical, tangible belongings, we have to treat our relationship the same. No, let me correct that.
Better.
We have to treat it better. We have to go far above and beyond.
Yeah.
Like the word says, you know, God can do exceedingly abundantly, far above and beyond all that we can ask. We have to be on it.
Yeah.
We have to be more on the relationship than we on anything else that's a part of our lives. All of the physical stuff, all of the material possessions we have. You know, sometimes we worship and idolize these things. And these things, like the word says, they pass away. The canker worm and the thieves break through and steal. Moths, you know, it corrupts.
Yeah.
You know, these things are not going. They're going to pass away one day. And the things that truly matter. And a lot of times are the very things that we neglect.
Yes.
Am I right? We neglected on, like she said a minute ago, it's not all that important. I guess I'll get to it. Maybe. I feel like it today and other days I don't. It can't be sporadic. It can't be a day in the life. It has to be a way of life. You can't pick and choose Monday, Wednesday, Friday. I'm going to put it to my relationship Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, Sunday. I feel like being by. You know, kind of like this remote work, and it's this virtual stuff. Yep. You know, you're in the office some days, and other days you're at home. But guess what? You got to treat it, you know, up close, with an up close and personal approach every single day.
Yes.
You get married, and you have the ceremony, but the marriage starts after the ceremony, and you can't feed it one day and starve it 4 or 5 days and then come back. It's not going
to
be healthy.
Expect for it to be
and
fine.
Expect it for it to grow and to be full of life. You know, we have to treat our relationships and our marriages better than we treat anything else that we possess.
Absolutely. And I used to say all the time that the devil is always on his job 24/7. That means we need to be on ours 25/8.
Come on.
I used to say that all the time.
My goodness.
He on his job. But sometimes we ain't always on ours, mm-hmm. and then we wonder why.
We slipping.
Yeah, we slip.
And then we won't whine and complain.
We won't
blame him. The devil, this is the devil that. I hear a lot of preachers these days say, yes, sometimes it is the devil, but a lot of times
yes,
it's you.
Yes, my mom
is
you all the time.
It's
we,
you.
We give the devil too much credit.
Mm-hmm.
It ain't always the devil, honey. It's sometimes it is you.
I've heard a lot of preachers put it over the ears. They say we always quit the point finger at whatever else and whoever else. But he put it like this. He said, you have three fingers pointing back at you, and the thumb is on the way. So you have more pointing at you than the finger that you're pointing. The one finger that you're pointing is probably 10 times, you know, the chaos and the turmoil going on with you than the finger that you're pointing in the direction you believe is coming from.
Yeah.
So, you know. Yeah. That was when I first heard that, I first seen that illustration, you know, I was like, wow, that's deep, you know, that's serious.
Very much. As we conclude talking about the five love languages, y'all stay tuned next week, because tying in to that, we gonna talk about something real. Look, heavy, just a little bit. I mean, because it can go deep on this one, but we're gonna talk about the toolbox.
Oh my goodness.
The toolbox.
The toolbox. Okay?
The toolbox.
My goodness.
What's in your toolbox?
What's in your toolbox?
What kind of tools do you have in your toolbox? Okay. We're gonna talk about, because we're dealing with relationships, we're dealing with even, you know, your job, ministry, and all of that. What is in your toolbox?
And
there are things every day that sometimes you're going to have to fix.
Come on.
For real. There are things that you going to have to fix. On your job, what? You got to fix.
Right.
You may have to fix or create a report. You may have to fix your lunch, okay? Fix dinner. You may have to, you know.
If you're in school, you may have to correct or fix your assignment.
Fix your assignment.
Come on.
You know, there's always something that you're going to have to fix. And we're going to tie it in even to relationships.
Mm-hmm.
As we gave a little nugget on tonight, that you want to be careful and not miss anything, because you're going to have to fix it.
Yeah, you're going to have to fix it.
As we call it, we're going to jagged edge that thing.
We're going to jagged edge that thing. You got to go on and fix it.
Yeah.
And, but guess what? Are y'all ready for this? As they say in the song, are you willing? That's the prereq. Are you willing? And if you are willing, we can fix it.
Yeah.
And then they hit you with that, yeah, that's my part. And then he said, I got my tools with me. So, that's important. Y'all ponder that and meditate on that.
Absolutely.
Throughout the week, you know,
yes.
So until we come back next week. What is in your toolbox? And even better, do you have anything in your toolbox?
Come on.
Are your tools sharp? Or are they dull? I mean, all of that.
Come on.
But we're going to leave that alone.
You better come
we're
on.
We're going to let that alone until next week.
Yeah, you must start something. Y'all better think about that.
Think about it, family.
Come with your questions, because next week we're going to hit it, okay? We're talking about the toolbox, guys. The toolbox, okay? So think about it, okay? Thank y'all so so much.
Thank y'all, family.
For tuning in with us, coming on in our house, riding this journey with us, because you never know what you're going to get.
Never know.
Okay?
And it just might be some
gate on anything, okay? Right.
Just might be some good stuff, some good stuff that you could take and use.
Yes.
And as Q said earlier, please like and share. You know, don't keep it all. Don't be selfish with it. You know, don't be a hog.
Mom said, "Mom, thank you, Mama."
Thank you, Mama. Yeah, you are so right.
She said, "Good points and conversation is the key to it all."
Right.
Absolutely, we're gonna end with that because it is conversations, multiple. I don't care how many you have.
Right.
One can lead to another one, then another one can lead to another one.
Mm-hmm.
But always be in constant conversation, because that is the key. Okay.
Yeah, perpetual, guys. Ongoing.
Yes.
When something
yes.
is perpetual and ongoing, guess what? It's far less likely and improbable that something from the outside, an outside invader, intruder will get in. So
we thank y'all.
Thank y'all so much. We love y'all. Thank y'all for tuning in. We appreciate your support.
We'll
appreciate
see y'all
the love.
Next Thursday at 7 p.m., guys. Tune in. We are on YouTube and also Facebook Live. So we love you guys, and God bless you. And be safe out there. Be careful. Be diligent. We know there's so much going on, but take the Lord with you. As my granny used to say all the time, take the Lord with you everywhere you go.
You better not leave home without.
You better not. Okay.
Come on now.
They used to talk about American Express. Don't
mm-hmm.
leave home without.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The Lord trumps American Express. So you better take the Lord with you. I don't care where you go. You go out that door, you better have the Lord. He better be driving. How about that?
Come on. The Q, I'm going to say it like this. They have American Express. We have Heaven's Best. Come on now.
Yes. Come on, Heaven's Best. You better come on, Bars. As I say, Bars.
Bars. We spend bars around here. We love y'all, family.
We love y'all.
Thank y'all so much. Love y'all.
Good
see y'all
night.
Next week. Good night.
We'll see y'all.
Love y'all. Bye-bye.